Here in a minute, we'll start our online if we haven't already started it. Yeah, so we're on. Okay. So we welcome everybody here. So before we get started, let's just, I know we've been praying, but pray for those that are sick among us, but also just pray that the Lord would have his way as we go through this series. And we're going to be talking a lot about it. Yes, we have information, but more importantly, we just want the Holy Ghost to minister. We want the Spirit of the Lord to lead us, and then we'll go from there. So let's just pray. God, we love you. As we, oh God, come tonight, Lord, as a body of believers unified in one mind and one accord, God, we just ask that a supernatural healing, a supernatural transformation, metamorphosis, God, can occur. The objective is, God, that we are not just healed, but made whole, God, and we pursue you and to be like you, God. We just ask, God, that you would open our understanding, and Lord, not just from a word perspective, but a spirit perspective, a supernatural move tonight, God. We love you. We honor you. Let it be a safe place, God. A safe place. A safe place, God. We want to run into your long arms of mercy, God, and experience the safe place, Jesus. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Here's what we'll do. I know some folks wanting to take some notes, so I don't know if it's possible with maybe just one section of lights kind of low. I don't know, maybe those backlights. Maybe we could just do that, just the center backlights, and then leave the sides off and see if that's enough. So, folks, is that okay? Is everybody okay? Does anybody want all the lights on? No? Okay. Don't go to sleep on us now. but we welcome you here tonight. Thank you. It's good showing for prayer. Sister Donahue and I are going to, tonight's the first night of our shame series, and we have been praying and fasting about it. And of course, you know, like I said, we have some material, but more important, I just want the Holy Ghost to flow. And what better way to let the Holy Ghost flow than a quick, short video to start? Now, I'm going to show you a video, and you're probably going to go, Pastor, what in the world? My wife doesn't even know I'm going to do this. But Corey, to kick us off, tee us up with the video, and we'll go from there. Thank you. guess why? So does anybody see what happened there? What happened, Sister Alicia? Right. Anybody else see anything in there? What do you see, Mason? That's right. He was afraid. What else, Sister Angie? Yeah.
The part that it didn't show was he kept going. The version we saw is he kept going out to the wave. The wave actually hit him at one point, and it scared him. So he wouldn't even come out of that nest. And he saw the little crab. He saw that little red crab. When he saw that little red crab go out, he's like, if he can do it, then I can. So it got him out a little bit. Well, he got out there. The wave, you saw the wave. When he saw the wave, he would run away. But at one point, he stayed and he just ducked down. And when he opened his eyes, he saw the provision that came through the wave. What they didn't show was when he got it, he looked at when the wave came and he saw the provision, that little crab started going in all those shells. That's what they didn't show. And he was gathering food. And so he started gathering the food and he was throwing all of these shells. I mean, just going bananas back and forth over the beach, throwing all these shells to where the other people couldn't even contain it, basically. And then he was at peace. And so that was a little bit of the story that they did not show for whatever reason.
So you might be asking, well, Pastor, why did you show that? Well, one day you may be called to be a pastor. And the things that keep me up at night is that knowing that I am responsible as an under-shepherd for a flock, and each one of those flocks are unique, or each one of those members within that flock is unique, and everybody goes through struggles, and everybody goes through trials. And I'm not talking about the ones that go through struggles and trials, because usually you pray through and you're good. I'm talking about the ones that seem to take up the rear. The ones that something has happened, a wave has happened, and it has caused you to be affected by that wave, and it has caused you to see things through the lens that wave created, and it has, quite frankly, it has brought you to a place that it affects everyone differently. What your wave might be different than the person's beside you. It could have been abuse. It could have been mental abuse, physical abuse, sexual abuse. It could have happened in the third grade, where you got bullied. It could have happened by a parent, a mom, a dad, grandmother. It could have happened by watching a video. It could have happened. There's so many things. What we don't want to happen tonight is to rubber stamp this class. I don't know if you've ever heard that. Just, you know, that's shame. And then just move on. I sit before you tonight because the last time we showed our shame series, I'm in a different place today than I was when we showed that. The last time we showed it, I wanted to show it, and I wanted to move on. We are going to show some of the videos that Chester Wright has put together. But we want a safe place. Notice everyone in this room innately has a safe place, whether you are there consciously or subconsciously, you run to a safe place. Many of us in this room, you may have not had a great home life, but there may be something at least within the home that you remember that is a safe place. Some of you, it may have been a blanket. It may have been a room. It may have been a smell, and it causes you. The senses are perfectly is a perfect analogy. Many times, think about this. They say bake cookies when you're selling a house, so that when the people come through, they smell cookies. Why? It reminds you of home. And now I associate home with buying this home. So some of you today in this room, potentially, that when you smell that smell, you remember the fist, or you remember the abuse. And so the heart of your pastor today is not to pull the rug out from under you, not to point fingers, say, hey, I was told in the past, hey, just get over it. There's just, and I believe in the instantaneous healing of the Holy Ghost. I believe that. But I'm also a little wiser to the where to know that the Holy Ghost doesn't always repair instantly. The biggest thing that you're going to fight tonight in this place is really denial. Is denial. And no, I'm good. I'm good. No, I'm good. I don't want to go there. I'm good. Listen, I'm being safe because I don't want to push that agenda there. But I'm just saying that, yeah, you may be good, but your good is what you have portrayed as good. And you're so much better than where you are. And so, whether it's an intense, full, painful feeling or an experience that has caused some flawed behaviors, when we take a look, and I've been talking about this, and we're just laying groundwork now, but when we take a look of who we are, when we go back to our flawed first family, back into the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve, when they had sinned, that sinful nature, that self-preservation nature, that cover myself, right? Cover myself, that nature. Any parent in here, the first thing that we do whenever a child makes a mistake is, what did you do? What did you do? Look, I need you to tell me what you did. And so we look for, and it's just human nature, but we look for, we need a confession out of someone. And the reality is, even a criminal isn't guilty until they confess, right? Once they confess, or at least they find factual evidence that they did do it, right? Now that we know you did it, now here's your punishment. And so there are so many things involved with the series that we're going to be getting into. This is not going to be just this week. This is probably going to go sometime. And it's probably going to build. It's going to be like pulling back an onion. There might be some things that are uncomfortable, and I do feel like there's times when uncomfortableness does create an environment to learn. But I want you to know that you are loved. You are loved. And that you are in a safe place. What better way to come into an environment like this with brothers and sisters that we can trust one another, that we can unify. And the stronger we are as this base, as Bishop talked about on Friday night, the stronger we are at this base, the onslaught that's going to be coming, the people that are going to be coming are going to need a firm foundation. Do you want to say something?
Where do you begin with this?
With Piper.
With Piper. You just heard Pastor's heart when it comes to this. I really, again, like he said, I really don't want to put a rubber stamp on anything. I really think that this year is a year of emotional healing. Now, is it all going to happen this year? Is everything going to be uncovered? Is everything going to... I don't know. But I know that we're going to begin the journey. And wherever God takes us is where he's going to take us. I do know as we study, and I know even what God has done in my life, it is his will that we are made whole. That is his will. So, however, we're not going to put a time. And I think that's in the process of healing. I think that is one of the biggest things that we, a mistake or misconception or deception or whatever we want to call it, that we could ever do is put a time stamp on your healing. By the end of this shame series, I'm going to be healed. It may be the very thing that initiates your healing and you being made whole. So don't put a time stamp. Don't put any expectations other than God. Whatever you want to reveal in me, whatever you want to do in me, I open my heart. You play a role in your healing. You know that? You play a role in that. And I believe we're here tonight because me and Pastor have been on a 20-year journey. And I believe it's brought us to this head. I believe that in 2002, my journey began. And I told Pastor the other day, I said, this is going to be my life work. This is what I've been called for. Let me read something to you. Luke 4:18. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he hath anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. Now, the poor is not someone that in our social status, like poor, does not have, you know, a job or homeless or someone that's not financially doing well. That's not what he's talking about. He's talking about someone that is poor in spirit. Okay. So he hath anointed me to preach the gospel, the saving gospel to the poor. He hath sent me to heal the brokenhearted. Now listen to this part. To preach. This is the second time he said this. I'll read it from up here. To preach deliverance to the captive. Did it say he was going to say, bippity boppity boo, you're healed? It says he's going to preach deliverance, just as he preached the gospel. Okay? So he's going to preach deliverance to the captives and the recovering of sight to the blind, to set at liberty them that are bruised. Now, I know this scripture text is going to be brought up within this series. I've listened to this series many times, along with other resources. Pastor has exposed me to some resources. We've talked about it. We've prayed about it. We've cried about it. So we're going to preach to you the message of deliverance. At some point, our part in this is believing and having faith in the Word of God and having faith beyond your damaged emotions. Hey, I've tried it all. I've forgiven myself. I have forgiven those that have hurt me. I have forgiven myself for the acts that I've done. What do you do with the damage? What do you do with the damage of sexual abuse? The thought process that came as a result of that. What do you do with the damage of physical abuse? The parent that left you. What do you do with the damage that is still there? See, being baptized in Jesus' name and being filled with the Holy Ghost, I love what Brother Craig said the other day. That's just your birth certificate. That's your birth certificate. And I was taught the day you receive the Holy Ghost, everything's gone. Your sin is washed away. But the Bible says he's come to restore with the cankerworm and the locust what they've destroyed, the damage. So how can damage still be there? Right? We're going to touch these things. So there's damage left from the pornography that you looked at. You asked God to forgive you. You're not looking at it anymore. But the damage is there. You don't want to think about it. You don't want to talk about it. You don't want to address it. And in the church, when I was growing up, these things were not talked about. You just get over it. You rebuke it in the name of Jesus, and it's to leave. Well, I'm here to give you hope tonight. That's not how you do it. If it is a spirit, it will leave. But if there is damage and things that need to be healed, he's ready to for us to preach the gospel and the word of deliverance and give you tools that when those thoughts from that pornography come, they no longer cause you pain. I can't promise you the thought of when that person abused you will never come to you again, but I can promise you he can deliver you of the pain that it causes. And if you don't allow God to address these things in you, you will come up with strongholds and self-defense modes that are not healthy. And they are actually, you think you're self-preserving, but you're self-destructing. I want you whole. I want to be whole. In 2002, there was a tongues interpretation. My husband and I, when this journey began for me, it's really when one person starts the journey, it's both of you. It's the whole family. When my daughter's going through something, our whole family's going through it. And he has been on this journey. We have been on this journey together. In 2002, it started. God woke my husband up. He said, your family's getting ready to go through a major trial. He said, it's going to test your faith and your integrity. He said, is my family going to make it? Is my family, my wife going to be okay, or my kids? He said, you're all going to be okay. You're all going to make it. But you must go through this. When we went through this, I did not know at the time that it was shame. I did not know that it was damaged emotions caused not only, I want to say this, not only by what was done to me, but by sins I had committed. I didn't realize that me not dealing with them and shoving them down and keep shoving them, and I'm okay. I plead the blood of Jesus. I rebuke you, Satan, in the name of Jesus. He's going to keep coming at you with it. But God wants to deliver you from the emotional torment of it when he comes at you, so that when he comes at you, it has no effect. It started then. We went and got help. We tried to get help. What was said to us is you need to fast and pray more. You're not fasting, praying more. And what happened was we were fasting and praying so much. We were in the word so much. My husband was literally almost laying over me, speaking in tongues. until I went to sleep. There were angelic visitations in our home, literal angels visitations. There were tongues interpretations. We were doing everything spiritually that we knew to do. But one night we were in prayer, there was a tongues interpretation, and God said, through your sufferings, many will be changed. Many will be healed. He said, and you will have the victory. Now, unbeknownst to us, we did not know where that journey would take us. I'll never forget it. I was seeing a psychologist, and I told my husband some of the things we're going to share tonight. We're going to get into the meat here, but I just want to bring you guys down to my level and show you you're not abnormal. You're not crazy. You're not losing your mind just because of what you're going through, and you are not non-spiritual. What happens a lot of times is to cover our shame or to protect ourselves from others knowing what's going on, we put on a form of super spirituality. Hyper spiritual. And it's protection so that no one knows what's really going on.
Let me continue that. So for those of you, so what's hyper spirituality look like? Well, God's good. We're okay. God's good. Everything's good. Let's take it back. Let's take it back to a few years in Pentecost. Just make sure your sleeves are here and your skirt is here. And don't cut your hair. Now, I agree with that. I'm with that. What I'm trying to say is, instead of dealing with a heart, let's go ahead and look the part so I don't have to deal with the heart. And we had so many senior saints and elders walking around that are elders, many of them are no longer with us, that became their salvation. Yeah, and their protection. You see, I can control my sleeve length. I'm just challenged with forgiving somebody.
Or trusting God with my salvation. Yeah. It's His salvation, yeah. Not yours. And you've got to trust Him that it's His salvation and His love. Well, that will then produce the performance.
Out of the mouth, the heart speaks. And you can even see this. And again, just pray for people when you see this. But that issue of looking the part and not being the part becomes, it speaks so loud when you get around some folks. You just have to pray. You just have to, and you'll know what I'm talking about. In other words, they're quick to notice your outward flaws. So. Again, we're not going that path tonight. We may get into that as we get into the series, but I'm just trying to say, again, it's just another cover. That's maybe that what we do in the church, but let's talk about some of the things that we also do, right? To help ease the pain or to hide the problem. What do? We run to stuff. We run to drugs. We run to alcohol. We run to sex. We pornography or whatever it is. Whatever it is, I lose myself in gaming.
Prescription medications.
Prescriptions. Yeah,
abuse. We justify that. Now, I want to make this precursor or this clause. We understand that people have to take, and that's where I was going with this testimony. It took me going to a psychologist because I was on medications at the time. I were not against medications.
Absolutely.
Okay. When you're using them to cover up things so that you're not facing them, that's when it becomes dangerous. I went to his name was Dr. Kasor. He had been previously over the entire Harding OSU Hospital mental health. when I was growing up, mental health was not talked about. We call it mental health today, but we're going to show you in the Bible what they call it and how they address it. Anyway, I went to him. I was on medications. And I'll never forget this. He looked me in the eye. He was sitting there. He said, Karen, he said, these medications are not long-term, number one. He said, you do not have a mental illness. You are not mentally ill. He said, you are just depressed. He said, you're highly stressed, which is producing anxieties, which is producing depression. That is not, he said, it is not a mental illness. He said, you're just going through a rough time of life. And he said, these medications, because you're not sleeping for 7 days upon a time and you're not eating, I lost a lot of weight. Matter of fact, my ketone, my fat was eating my fat. And trust me, I was 121 pounds or so. And I was losing weight drastically at that weight. Okay. I could stand to lose my fat to eat my fat now. But then I couldn't. And he said, I have to prescribe something because he said it will help control the symptoms. He said, but whatever skeletons are in your closet, he said, these medications are not going to make those go away. He said, I don't know if you believe in a higher power. He said, but I suggest that you go to your higher power and you take your skeletons in the closet and you bring them out and you deal with them with that higher power. And my husband said, oh, we go to church, you know. He said, if I can give you any advice, he said, you need to go to God and you need to go to prayer and you need to address these things with him. Well, I did a little bit. I let him touch one thing. I let him touch one area. That was enough. That was enough I could stand or bear. And God healed me in that area of my life. He did. And one day I'll share with you what that is. But not tonight, I'm not. But God healed me. I allowed that to surface and come to the surface and literally let God slice, like literally let that infection come out. Well, here we are, years go by. I'm fighting the same thing, but for different reasons. And I go on a fast. I don't know how long the fast was. I don't even know what I did, but I know I went on a fast. Usually it was cutting out a lot of media, any voices we would do a lot of times. Went on a fast. And in that fast, I said, God, what is wrong with me? I need to know. I need you to reveal to me what is wrong with me. Why am I constantly afraid? Why am I constantly fighting fear? Why am I constantly depressed? What is going on? And God is my witness. A voice, a whispering voice went, shame. I was like, wow. Okay, well, I can't deny that. Called my mentor. I said, what is this? She gave me her short definition. And I chalked it up and I said, I'm healed. I don't have time to deal with this. God, do you know how busy I am for you? No. Do you understand how many Bible studies I'm teaching? I'm leading doves. I'm in the choir. My husband's an evangelist. I don't have time to deal with this. So I'm healed. Hallelujah, praise God. Shame is when I don't believe that I'm good enough for what God's done for me. Hallelujah, I got revelation. I'm moving on. I moved on. But I was crawling. And I thought that I was doing a lot, but I really wasn't doing what God wanted me to do. And it's what I'm doing tonight. I think I could have arrived here a lot sooner. What we're doing tonight. So then 2 years ago, and I know I've told this testimony, but I'm going to tell you again, because there's someone here that needs to hear it. 2 years ago, I was at a breaking point because I moved on. I didn't try. God, we're pastoring now. You are not digging nothing up. I remember how bad that pain was. You are not digging it up right now. We don't have time for this. 2 years ago, or 2 to 3 years ago, Bishop was here. Now, who's ever gotten this from Bishop? I have. Calls me over here to the side of the platform, and he says, Sister Donahue, I was in prayer today. He said, in our hotel room. And he said, the Lord spoke to me and told me that you are battling the stronghold of shame. I said, did my husband tell you anything? He said, no, he did not. He said, the Holy Ghost revealed it to me today. And he began to tell me verbatim. It was like I'm at a doctor's office, and he's like, this symptom, this symptom, this symptom, this symptom, this symptom. Okay. I was like, that's me. I got it. But even then, I felt relief. But where do I go with this? Like, what do I do? Now I know what it is. How do we heal from here? And I kept going through major episodes. This woman here that's up here prophesying and leading the church in worship and going through episodes of despair, hopelessness. I'm not ashamed or afraid to say it. Depression. Because I could not measure up. And all these things from the abuse and all these things, the damage would come to the surface and I would shove it back down. And all along he's saying, I just want to heal you. Will you give me the time to heal you? As I thought about us talking about this today, and Pastor's going to start in a minute, I just, again, I want to bring it down, and I want you guys to feel comfortable. This is very uncomfortable for me. I didn't even want to be on live stream. I'm more comfortable not doing live stream. I'm exposing myself tonight. But if it is going to set someone free and give someone the courage to step out, be it unto me. It's been 20 years. Captives are going to be set free. People are going to be delivered. People that have been bruised are going to be set at liberty, because you're going to receive sight and understanding of why you've been feeling the way you've been feeling. You've rebuked it. You've pled the blood of Jesus over it. It hasn't gone away. I'm telling you, I've tried to be the perfect person, the perfect house, the perfect family, the perfect pastor's wife, the perfect, everything had to be perfect. Then it turned into perfection. And that about wore me out. It wore him out. The carpet lines. The self-destructive habits. And you may think, This is not for me. I don't fight shame. You wait till we start and digging and how paralyzed you are, and you don't even realize it. And Brother Cheshire Wright, we're going to intertwine the videos, even some other reading points, literature into this as well as the Bible. But I'm going to tell you, your worst enemy is denial. And the super spirituality that makes you think that it can't happen to you. And this is not me. God's going to give us hope. He has given us hope. He's given us the answers. We've got to believe him. And so we're here tonight. So as we go on this journey, I don't know who exactly are going to be the teachers. I know Sunday night, Pastor had mentioned, unless you've really gone through it, you know. But I'm going to, on this journey, I don't know if we're going to turn this off at times or whatever, but I am going to open up my heart at times, and I know he will too, because Jesus suffered so that we could be whole. We are not shy of suffering so that others. We commune with him in his suffering. So, Mary had to suffer rejection. She had to suffer through them really not even identifying Jesus as a legitimate child, so that this world, a Savior could be birthed through her, and this world could experience freedom and liberty. So just wanted to share that with you. You are not weird. You are not crazy. You're not, I was demon possessed. You are not demon possessed. Matter of fact, you're quite opposite. He wants to kill and destroy by playing on the shame, by playing on the pain. So you're not possessed by the devil. You're getting ready to be possessed by truth, and you're going to crush him under your feet. Want me to continue?
So, and just from the very beginning, so the definition of shame.
The definition of shame. I don't have it on my computer.
Your definition.
My definition of shame is.
No, without looking.
No, I'm pulling up, but I'm not going. No, I won't. Just, okay, my definition of shame is basically what it boils down to. Is not being worthy, is this place of unworthiness and despair and hopelessness and darkness that you feel, remember, feelings are not accurate, but you feel as though you will never escape it and that you will ever be good enough for anyone, anything. And so, therefore, you have to create salvation or perfectionism or whatever it may be to be worthy.
So that was her definition. And think about that. I in my mind, I think I'm not worthy. I'm not, you know, no one will love me. I will never be good enough. And so just those three things right there, right? I'm unworthy. So if I look at myself as being unworthy, unlovable, unwanted, kicked to the curb, right? Suddenly, if this becomes my belief, this becomes my mindset, the one that I need to believe that he made me worthy, he loved me, that's just too far out there.
It's almost like a fairy tale.
It's a fairy tale.
Yeah.
It's a fairy tale. And so then our relationship with God really isn't a relationship. It just becomes the churchy thing to do. Yeah. I'll show up on Sunday, right? I'll do that. But that's really about it, because I've just been taught that if you just show up, you're spiritual. Is this okay? I mean, we're going to be real, right?
Or you're showing up because you're trying to earn him.
Well, that's almost the, like, that's the other side.
Almost like punishing yourself. I've got to prove to you that I love you so that maybe I get sprinkled with your love. Maybe I will get something. I'm not worthy of it. Kind of like the prodigal son. I'm not even worthy. But Jesus brought out restored him right back.
Right.
But God, I will give my life to you
Well,
because I'm not worthy of your love.
But here's
it's almost
but let's talk about even that. We're unscripted, right? Reading the story of the prodigal, I could see Jesus taking him back, but he would never take me back. It's easy to think that they'll do it for somebody else, but for me, I'm too far gone. The stronger the fear, or stronger the voice of shame, the stronger that voice is in our hearts, the more we use the threat of punishment and disconnection as our solution. My sister may be watching tonight. I hope so. I love my sister. Nonstop abusive relationships. And I asked her one day, sis, I said, sis, why? She goes, well, I deserved it. And we all probably know some folks like that, right? You do not deserve that. You have been thrust into a situation where I feel like that's the best I can get, and if I get abuse from that, well, I deserved it anyway. Yeah. And again, I'm going to keep going back and forth, because the reality is see, shame won't allow you to really know who you are and whose you are. And when you have a healthy understanding, I'm talking about, you know, I'm going back to Piper up here. Piper, all he sees is the wave. All he sees is the damage that was caused by the wave. And as long as that's all you see, right, you'll stay in the nest. Now, let's bring it home, right? You'll never get involved. You'll never find a healthy relationship. You'll never find a place of forgiveness. You'll never see yourself as anything but just, that's the best I can get. Is this okay? It may not be.
And I want to again bring it back to the church. I know we're ministering to everybody, whether if you're watching tonight, you may not be a member to a church, or you may not attend church faithfully. But I also want to address those that attend faithfully. Yeah. Again, it can turn into you do what you do trying to earn. Even it can go into where your schedule's so heavy because you're trying to earn forgiveness. You're burning yourself out at the church because you're trying to earn something that is already yours.
Well,
it can turn into such, even within the church, it can turn into things that are not healthy. And we're sitting on the pews, a lot of us. I cannot tell you how many pastors' wives, different people that I talk to that are being led by this. They're not enjoying the great, sweet salvation of a loving Savior that is literally here saying, it's yours already. If you would just believe me. And so we're basing our performance again on trying to earn, when we really, our performance should be a result of his love, our understanding, and our revelation. And then that's when we don't guilt ourselves and say, I'm not doing enough. I'm not doing enough. I got to do more. No, you say, you know what, God, because you love me, I need to rest. You command me to rest. And this is what I can do within the time. And this is my purpose and my calling. I could not wait to get here tonight. There's things I'm not excited to be here about. Can I be real at times? I'm not excited about everything that I do. But I know what this is going to do for people. And so you'll get to that point when you get this revelation, church people. I want the church people to hear this, of the destructive habits that this can create.
She was starting down this path, but behind our efforts to intimidate people into compliance of good behavior. In other words, think about your parenting skills. Think about this. Is go clean your room, go do this, and then I'll let you go. Now, there's nothing wrong with getting somebody to clean their room. There's nothing wrong with, you know, being good. I'm not saying that. But what we do is we put performance as the solution to behavior. And quite frankly, we do that with God. I've got to be perfect so he loves me. I've got to be perfect so I'll be blessed. I've got to be perfect. I've got to do all these things perfect. Let me tell you, the only thing that was perfect was his sacrifice. Now, we're going to talk a little bit about that in a future things, but in a healthy way. There's nothing wrong with being good, doing good. Nothing wrong with that. But when I think that earns something, then we're looking at it from the wrong perspective. We'll get into shame. We're going to start getting into some of this now. But listen, if this is a core belief of yours, that my flaws and failures make me unworthy of love, belonging, and connection, I deserve punishment. I deserve to be disconnected. And by the way, usually if I'm in that mindset, we see it in everybody else too. I mean, the person that's dealing with this, as soon as you say something about them, say, well, this is what you're doing. Well, look at you. Look what you do. And look what they did and what they did. Never. See that now you've got to have a self-realization about who you are and what you're involved in. I'm not going to deal with that. I would much rather point my finger and say, this is what you're doing. This is what you're doing.
Because it makes you feel better. Because it makes you feel better. That justification. It makes you feel better.
Mm-hmm. Do you ever notice one of your, some of us got grandchildren. Well, I don't have them yet, but I'm praying for grandchildren. But
Dylan said he's going to watch this. Dylan and God's timing.
I've got a couple.
God's timing.
I've got some grandpups, but I want some grandkids. And then, but I hear everybody talk about how good they are. Matter of fact, they say they're so good they would have bypassed their kids to have them. That's what I hear. But for those grandparents out there, or parents, what happens? What does Timmy or Sally do when they get in trouble? What's the first thing they do? Say it loud. That's one thing they do. What's the most common thing that they want to do? Say it. They've got to hide. They've got to hide. Can I, as your pastor, can I just say this? Some of you, instead of facing it, you run and hide. Now, you may do something wrong. I know pastor wouldn't like this. So instead of facing pastor, because I become that authority figure, I'm going to run and hide. I'm not going to text him. I'm not going to call him. I'm going to avoid it. Why? Because avoiding that avoids punishment. Let me ask you a question. I don't think there's one person in this room except for Sarah that I have punished. I don't think there's anybody in here. I may have raised my voice to a couple of you, and don't say amen because they'll know it's you. But I may have raised my voice and it was firm. I was kind of like when George Washington, the first time they elected him, he goes, I can only promise you two things, humility and firmness. And so, but I have raised my voice, and then maybe for a couple of you, I've limited some event or something like that. But the reality is, you're here, you're alive. So the nature of the person, again, what has taught, not the church, but what life has taught you, it has bled into your relationship with God, that as soon as I feel like I've done something wrong, now I go hide. I don't want to feel the pain.
Well, and you can take that, and I will share with you even me. There are things, this is hard because I know we're live. So I'm going to be very vague. There are things that happened to me in life that perverted things that God created to be beautiful and to be natural. And because what happened to me, the act, it made it dirty and perverted and unclean. Right? Which is not biblically correct. But my feelings told me, this is not right, this type of behavior and actions. And so when you carry that into something that's ordained of God, a relationship, when something happens, it always feels unclean and you feel dirty. So I don't feel worthy to come before God. I feel like I'm constantly doing something wrong. And I hide from him. And I hide from a relationship because I would rather not even have the relationship and deal with the shame, or just stay away from God so that I don't have to deal with him shaming me. And it's not even coming from God. How many of us have heard in preaching, I think I might have even said it before, if you feel that it's not right, if you feel dirty or unclean after you do it, it's probably wrong, it's sin. Or that's an indicator it's sin. But when you fight shame, you feel unclean all the time. So then you need to know what's true. Or you don't know. You feel unclean all the time. You feel ashamed off and on all the time. And because that feeling that comes with the abuse or my sin that I committed, I feel like I'm doing something wrong all the time. And I can't get out from underneath the weight of the guilt. I can't go face God. It's just easier to hide. It's easier to put on the super spiritual mask, the hair, the skirt, raise my Bible, pump my Bible, have my Bible all highlighted so when I flip it open, y'all can see all the highlights. Right? It's easier to do that than to face that pain. Because that pain tells me I might be rejected. That pain tells me he may not want me. That's what I'm telling you. It's getting awful quiet in here. That pain tells me, what if he doesn't want me now? I can't even pick this up and read it because he's going to hurt me. Because I'm dirty all the time. I'm unclean. I will never be able to live up to this. Why even try to read this? But I'll try to earn you. I'll try to earn you. I'll try to win souls for you, to prove to you that I'll do better. And I'll read my Bible every day, one chapter every day. There's nothing inherently wrong with reading your Bible every day and praying every day and winning souls. But when your motive is fear and shame and you're trying to earn him, it's wrong. And you need to sit down and say, God, we're going to a prayer closet. I want healed. This is where I had to get. God, the good, bad, ugly, let's do this together. I'm tired of living this day in and day out. This cannot. I would see him wake up and he's, man, faithful, faith. And I'm like, how do you get that? How are you like that? He's like, I'm delivered. I'm set free. His word tells me that I'm loved. And I'm like, how do you know that? I don't feel that. I don't believe that. That's shame. And it could be very well by something you've done. We're dealing, right now, this world is dealing with pornography rampant. And the effects and the shame. I've talked to people where their sons and daughters are different, are wanting to commit suicide that are in the church because they've looked at pornography and they are so ashamed that they feel like they, and those pictures are in their minds. And because those pictures come to their mind, because you cannot, now listen, your birth certificate, right? Baptism in Jesus' name, filled with the Holy Ghost, right? You're going to fall. You're going to make mistakes. That's what God's love and his grace and his mercy is for. But you can't erase. I remember Brother Tiller used to say, he said, I used to look at dirty magazines, and he said, I wish I could take Clorox and scrub my mind. But what do you do with the damage? The shame. When that thought comes to their mind and it triggers a feeling and they're like, oh God, I'm unclean. I can't come before you. I can't do this anymore. Why should I even live for you? This is going to keep coming back. These thoughts, they will come back. But what you need to do is not hide from him. You need to run to him and say, God, let's address these thoughts. If they're not going to leave me, you're going to give me power to overcome them. And you're going to remove the desire, God, and you're going to give me power to overcome and not yield to the desire. That's shame. And there are people that are not pastors, and they are not missionaries, and they are not evangelists. Because the devil, you are going to fail. But he's got you tied up in shame. And I think that's one of the greatest frustrations for him. Watching me or others, he's saying, I know what they're fighting now. And he said, I can't change it for them. But that's why we're here tonight. That's why we're here tonight. We're going to talk about things that usually we don't talk about that causes shame. It's not just from abuse. It's not just from, it's from things that we've done. It could be an abortion. It could be Brother Chester Wright talking about a grandmother. God have mercy. I can't even imagine this. He said there was a grandmother. She was on her way to a grocery store. She was a pastor's wife. She was visiting her children, going to the grocery store to make a grocery run, a simple grocery run. Unbeknownst to her, her 2 or 3-year-old granddaughter or grandson was behind the car. And she hit that child and killed that child. And went to the store, didn't even know she had hit it. She had a large SUV, didn't even know she had hit it. That was an accidental thing. He said, but the shame that this woman is enduring, has to endure. And he said, God has come to set her free. It could be an accident. It could have been something that was, you didn't even mean to do. But the implications and the damage from that. You can forgive yourself and that person all day long. But God, here we go. Here's the aftermath of the tornado. I need repaired. I need healed. I need you, God, and I'm not going to run from you anymore. This is you and me. But to get there, you've got to believe, and we're going to get into that here, that he loves you.
I feel like praying right now. Would you pray with us? Come on, would you just pray just for a moment? Come on. We're dealing with humanity. We're also going to face a spiritual warfare when we invite people to rewrite their lives as a result of his goodness and grace, understanding of where he wants us to be, not just repaired, but made whole. Made whole. It was it was Gary Blanken's wife, Holly brought Gary. I think the very first time Gary came to church, Gary had hair down to the middle of his back, and he had a gun with him, and he probably had a few other things that he was dealing and. That was during the week, and then on Sunday, there was a guy in a suit, and he had a bag. He had his hair in it. That was Gary. He had cut his hair. He shaved. He put the suit on, and he hadn't received the Holy Ghost or anything like that. You know, it was just overnight. Holly had won. She was selling real estate. She had won something, and she had won a trip to Hawaii. And Holly and Gary was there. And she says that they were on a tour bus in Hawaii, and some folks from the Hawaiians had got on the bus, and Gary started speaking Hawaiian, you know, making fun of them, what? And she turned and she elbowed him, and when she looked, his hands were raised. He was crying. God filled him with the Holy Ghost on the tour bus. And she came back and she testified. She says, I tried AA and NA, and I said I was this and said I was that. I tried all that stuff. She goes, but nothing changed him like being filled with the Holy Ghost. And so there is an element. There is. And I believe that. I believe that. But that's the beginning. But that doesn't mean we're not going to struggle. That means that we're not going to have challenges. If anybody has seen my car out here, I went up for a doctor's appointment in December. And while I was inside getting x-rays, somebody decided to smash into my lease. And so this happened in December. I wasn't in the car. Everything's, I'm fine. But here we are a month later, my car is still damaged. What do you do? What do you do when you're past the accident, but yet there's still damage? And so we're going to, we've got 4 minutes to go. We're going to go just four more minutes. But I want to read this to you from our series. It says, the removal of shame from the lives of God's people is the last step before the promised outpouring of the Holy Ghost in the last days. According to Joel chapter 2, verse 25 through 28, it says this, and I will restore to you the years that the locust has eaten, the canker worm, yeah, the damage, the caterpillar, the palmer worm, my great army which I sent among you. And ye shall eat in plenty and be satisfied, and praise the name of the Lord your God that hath dealt wondrously with you, and my people shall never be. So they must have been shamed. As a matter of fact, watch this. Where did it begin? When Adam and Eve was in the garden and they were naked, the Bible says, and they were not ashamed. Shame, the ability to shame, the reasoning of shame came at the fall. It's in our humanity. It's in our DNA. And that's why when it becomes a stronghold in you and the enemy knows what button to push, when an enemy, it becomes a spiritual battle when it becomes a spiritual stronghold and the enemy knows what button to push. You think that this is going to be easy just to walk out of. It's going to be a spiritual battle. That's why we prayed and fasted Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. I want you to know that Sister Donahue and me, we want to partner with you so that we have a healthy, unified body. And I really feel like that the reason why I was struggling with this, because we wanted to have some leadership courses. But think about this. Some of you who have come from the secular world, and you know, some of you, you know, I think of Heather. I think of Sister Rosie was a nurse. I think of some of you that came from Corey Ring at IT at the hospital. You know, Sister Melissa and others. You've come from a corporate world, secular world, where you know you could probably teach leadership, right? You talk about all this and different things. Here's the thing. We can teach leadership principles, but if I don't feel good, I'm not doing it. If I don't see any value in myself, how can I value a leader? How can I lead? Here's what I'll do. I'll get engaged a little bit and I'll stay home. Now, that sounds like, Pastor, you're picking on me. No, I'm not, because you're better than just getting involved in a little bit and then staying home. You're better than that. You just don't know it.
Let me say this too. Now, has God done things through me, and has he been glorified through me during my pain, during my journey? Yes. Yeah. The Bible says he's caused me to be fruitful in the land of mine affliction. He can cause you to be fruitful during your affliction. Joseph, he named one of his children Manasseh, and is Ephraim and Manasseh, and one of those names means he caused me to be fruitful in the land of mine affliction. You can be fruitful. Just make sure your motive is not you trying to burn yourself out and earn God's love. God, you're using me during this time. You're being glorified during my brokenness. God, I'm still going to be in this lead position. You've called me to be here. I don't understand it, but do whatever you got to do in me. Or God, I'm going to come to church and be faithful against how I feel and what I think about myself, because God, you're going to be glorified and I'm going to get further understanding. You can't say, well, this is who I am. This is what I'm fighting. I give up. There was many times I wanted to do that. You can't. You know how many times I've had come in here during the beginning of this journey and lead worship, and I didn't even know how I was going to tell you how to worship a God that I couldn't feel? And I had to say, God, I need you to do through me what I don't have in me right now. Help me with my unbelief. Help me in my pain. And it has made me stronger. It has strengthened my faith. I've had to push through my feelings. So don't allow it to continue to paralyze you. Say, God, cause me to be fruitful. Now, however God that looks to you, in the land of mine affliction. Because you know what? During Joseph's affliction, that was rejection. I mean, no greater rejection comes from your family. That's some deep type of rejection right there. Right. Okay? But God caused him. And he named his other son, which, and I'm paraphrasing, so brother, I know Brother Craig, he's our theologian here, but it basically means he caused me to forget. One caused him to forget. But he said, God caused me to be fruitful in the land of mine affliction. You can be fruitful. You can do something for God during and through your pain.
Right.
I would have never thought that I was worthy enough or chose to be a pastor's wife and all this stuff. Those are just titles. But he chose to put me here and to lead during this. Joseph led through that.
You know, let me just add something, right? See, your years into this, you can say that.
Yes, sorry.
You know, so I'm giving her a little rebuke right now is because she hasn't always been able to say what she's saying right now. But she's able to say that now because she's on, and I love it, she has come so much further than she's ever been in the last few years. But watch this, right? So if shame is, if I'm so full of shame or I'm so full of my toxic behavior and I'm so full of striving and isolation and fear, I can't imagine life without it.
And you will literally at times taste it and feel it and not know how to stay there. It's so much easier just to revert back to the worry and the fear. It's comfortable. It's a cozy little place. I'm familiar with this. Real quick, and I know he's going to go a little bit further, and I know it says unresolved shame. Unresolved shame is the most debilitating spiritual condition with which we contend today. It is the root cause of almost all Christian inconsistency. Check for me. I could not be consistent because one day I felt like I was worthy. One day I didn't feel like I was worthy. One second I felt worthy. Okay, I can fight the world. I can go win the world. One day I didn't feel worthy. I can't do this. I can't commit to anything because I don't know if tomorrow I'm going to feel worthy.
Can I tell you how that happens? Because our humanity is addicted to power. And as long as I can say, hey, I feel good, I'm going to do that. Oh, I don't feel good, I'm going to back up. I'm in control, not him. Yeah. I'm in control. I'm going to tell myself I don't feel good, so I'm backing away.
I was addicted to my perfection.
Yeah.
Which was my cover-up.
We're addicted to it.
Yeah, which was my cover-up, which was my comfort zone, which made the pain go away. So if I couldn't be perfect that day or have everything in line, then I'm not worthy. I can't do it. I'm not worthy. He doesn't want me. He's not going to walk with me. Yeah. He's not going to be there when I'm there.
Yeah.
Because I'm not worthy.
So it
will cause almost all Christian inconsistency. It is the primary reason why we do not pray faithfully. Yeah. It is the foundational reason for almost all backsliding. I'm not saying it's all, but if you feel like I've gone too far, I cannot live up to this. Why am I even doing this? I can't live up to you, God. Why am I even living like this? That has crossed my mind. What am I even doing this for? I'm afraid to go to hell. So I'm going to do it.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm just being real. That's what it came down to. And then I thought, there's got to be more to this great salvation that he's telling me about and that I see in him. Thank God for this.
Well, you know, it's hard to be humble. So it's hard.
But I would see him. He makes mistakes, y'all. But he lives a victorious life. I'm like, how does this work? I mean, literally, at one point, I'm like, something's wrong with me. Finally, I admitted it. Something's wrong with my thinking. And there's all different degrees of shame. It could be something minor but causing something major in your life.
Yeah.
It could be something so minor and you not become that Sunday school teacher because of it.
Let me just be a victim of pain. That's what I'll be good at. I'm a victim of pain.
So this Bible study, what we're talking about, it's going to examine shame and its effect upon the lives of God's people. And it, like the Lord, it's going to start with the end before the end, the beginning. And what's the most important result for the church when the people of God are free from shame? Pastor was reading it in Joel 2, 25 through 28. Yeah. He stopped at 26, 27.
Let me read 27 and 28, and we're done. And you shall know that I am in the midst of Israel, and that I am the Lord your God, and none else, and my people shall never be ashamed. And it shall come to pass afterwards.
After he restores. After he heals. After he restores.
That I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh, and your sons and your daughters shall prophesy, your old men shall dream dreams, and your young men shall see visions.
Then the end shall come.
Yeah.
And I'm so ready.
So, yes. So the reality is there's a prophetic utterance about God delivering his people from shame, but we don't have to wait for that time out there. If you're ready, it starts tonight. Pastor, you're not going to get me to go there. I want you to, but it's going to take some time for some of y'all.
And you're not a failure.
Say it again.
His key slogan is shame. Your failures are not your final. If tonight you're not ready to face that pain, it's okay. It's okay. You're not a failure. He is a gentleman. He'll give you grace and he'll give you truth. And he'll wait with you. Now, the longer you wait, it's kind of like that surgery you need to get done or that thing you need to get taken care of. It's up to you. He's going to leave it up to you. He's not going to force you. I'm not going to force you. Pastor, it's 20 years in for me. It's 20 years. And I'm going to tell you, you're not going to be perfect. I think one of the key things in the shame series is this, and I want to share this, and it has been a key factor in my healing, is being able to find someone you can trust when you're ready to face that pain.
Yeah. Yeah.
It could be your husband or your wife. My husband is my absolute, the Bible says to love the Lord thy God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. I love this man. I told my son today, I love your daddy with everything. I cannot be sure of, it's a little bit shorter than what I love you, Jesus, but I love him with everything. Now, let me tell you, because of the abuse and the things that had happened to me, that's had to even develop over years. Not because of what he's done or not because of who he is. It's because of what others did. And it's because of who he is and what he's done for me, I am able to trust him. There are people that you can trust, people that have been hurt and abused, or people that you've even made a mistake and you're so afraid to bring it to the surface because you're afraid someone's going to think you're some low-down, dirty person and they won't love you. That's a lot of reason why people that fight shame won't let it come up. Because they're afraid they're going to be rejected and never loved and wanted. That is one of the biggest lies ever, that spirit, that I believe it begins as a spirit. It tells you a lie. And then you just become your own bully. You become your worst enemy, right? That is the worst thing that shame tells you, is that if you expose it, you're not going to be wanted and you're not going to be loved. And you're going to be rejected. I promise you. There may be some people that do that. And that's what held me up for my healing. Because I was like, well, what if this person agrees, but this the person doesn't? What if this person says it? I don't care. What does he say? And I'm here to tell you, he loves you unconditionally. I don't care what you've done. David said, if I made my bed in hell, he will find me there. Right? So I would say find a safe place. And when you say it, and I'm telling you, it will take everything in you to bring it out, right? I'm telling you, it's because you've believed this lie that no one will love you and want you. I promise you, someone will love you. First of all, he will, right, when you bring it out to him.
Right.
I have felt nothing but the love of God when I bring it to him. Now that I've done it, I've had the courage to do it. But things that I thought that he would no longer want me. I mean, this is the lies I told. Shame. Okay, I'm telling you, this is how crazy. I have found such a safe place in him. It has helped me with my healing. So find someone that's safe. They're not going to reject you. Matter of fact, you may say, they may say to you, I fight that too. And you help them. You would be very surprised.
Let me tell you who not a safe person is. You expose yourself to them and they say, okay, let's go now have physical relationship. Let's go. There were months on end. You know, God designed us. He designed male and female. He designed that relationship between a husband and wife. But when you're broken on the inside, you don't feel worthy on the outside. So
you're going to want that person that's going to, they're going to walk it with you.
Exactly.
They're going to pray with you. They're going to lead you to your Savior and not join in with you to draw you away from him.
Exactly.
Because he is the only, I'm telling you right now, I've done it all, tried it all to make this try to go away. I've super spiritualized even. It's not going to go away.
Yeah.
Until you feel that you can be safe with God.
So.
And that he loves you and that you're safe and you can expose it. And you need to put yourself around people that are going to push you into him even when you don't feel like you're worthy and that you can do it. You need those kind of people. That type of safe place. And so tonight, we said we closed. I'm that preacher that keeps saying that. But I'm just saying, tonight, if I know how you're feeling, the people that are fighting it, you're already saying, I'm not going to face this. I don't want to do it. I don't have time for it. It's okay. He'll wait for you. And there are people that love you that are waiting on you too. He will wait for you when you're ready.
So we're going to pray. And then here's what I'd like, because there might be some folks that just want to, if you stick around and pray, you're not exposed. You're not exposed. You say, well, if I stick around and pray, then they're going to know what they're talking about me. No, you might be praying for somebody else. We want it to be a safe place, right? So we're going to pray one more time, and if you need to go, God bless you. We'll see you Sunday, right? Sunday morning, Sunday night. But for others that just want to just stay around and pray, would you help us pray? Everybody in the room, would you just help us pray? God, again, we come, God, tonight, just beginning to expose some things, opening some ideas, some thoughts, God, so that the healing balm of Gilead can just flow in the hearts of people. I bind and rebuke the spirit, God, that is trying to kill, steal, and destroy. God, when you created us, in your image, in your likeness, oh God. And Lord, you, in your supernatural ability, can make us whole and new and Lord, repair us as though it has never occurred, God. Give somebody, God, strength tonight. Give them the courage, God, tonight, Lord. Give them the boldness tonight, Lord. Lord, that I could be everything that you've called me to be. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. God bless you.